We have looked at the circuits in the receiver, basically the amplifier circuits. Other than that, we mainly need the decision latch and other latches to make the demultiplexer. Similarly, it's the same kind of flip flops can be used for the multiplexer and so on. Okay, and these other circuits required for offset correction and so on, they are also just differential pairs which add some currents into whatever nodes that you want. So, I won't discuss them further. But the most important thing in the receiver is, of course, the decision latch, that is the latch which takes the, which resolves the input analog value into either a logic 1 or logic 0. Okay. And essentially, most of them, or in fact all of them, would have a two phase operation amplification and regeneration. The part where the output voltage will be sort of proportional to the input voltage, and after that it goes into regeneration mode, where starting from that initial condition the voltages are resolved to full rail. Okay. And there are many architectures for this. Essentially every flip flop works like this, right? Every flip flop also has this regeneration mode where lot of static flip flops have this regeneration mode where there is some positive feedback and then it resolves the levels into either 1 or 0. Now, in this case there are too many options. There is mainly one type of latch which is known as the strong arm latch, which is widely used. And there are some enhancements to that which I won't describe, but the basic strong arm latch we will look at. Okay. Now, what is it? First of all, how do you make a regenerative pair? You are familiar with this circuit, I assume, two inverters back to back. So, now this will hold some state stably, because once somehow this gets resolved to 1 and this is 0, that gets reinforced, right? Because the 0 input gives you 1 through this inverter and this 1 input gives you 0 through that inverter, and basically it stays that way forever. Okay? And such a latch is part of any regenerative latch, but in case of the strong arm stuff, we have the same. These are two inverters and it is connected like that. The output of this goes to that and the output of this goes to that. Okay. Now, again if I ground the bottom, basically it becomes the same as this and it will hold some state. Now, in our case, what is it that we want to do? We want to establish an initial condition based on the input voltage, and then that initial condition should get amplified into logic 1 or 0. Okay? So, now in this case also, how does it go? Like which way becomes 1 and which becomes 0? So, let us say there is it could be biased wherever, but let us assume that we have the self bias voltage of the inverter plus some delta V, and here we have self bias voltage minus some delta V. If you bias it around that, it is best, but it does not have to be like that. Now, if delta V is positive, the left side will go to the upper rail, and if delta V is negative, the left side will go to the lower rail. Okay? So, that delta V is what we want to establish on these nodes before you start regenerating. Okay? So, there are many ways you can think of doing this, okay, with multiple clock phases and so on. Somehow you have to, for instance, you could have this, and initially, by the way, this positive feedback, right, once it is held, it will hold it that way. Okay. To disable it, for instance, what you could do is this. If you do that, basically it gets shorted. What will be the voltages on either side? It will be the self biased voltage. Okay. So, then there is no positive feedback, the positive feedback is broken. So, what you could do is, for instance, you could do this. Of course, the switch will have some resistance. So, some difference voltage can exist between the two sides. Then, for instance, you could have IP and IM drawn from the two sides. If IP is more than IM, the left side voltage will go below the right side voltage. And then, what you do is you perhaps disable these things and then you open the switch. Then it will start from that initial condition and regenerate. Okay. So, that is one of the ways of establishing initial conditions. Now, there are so many latches that you can, that are there that have been used, and also you can think of your own topologies. Essentially, the idea is you should have a regenerative pair. You should initially reset the regenerative pair, because otherwise what happens is previously held state will still hold. Okay. You can't overcome that. So, typically these things involve a reset. So, once you reset, the previous state is cleared, and then you establish initial conditions on the regenerative pair with the right polarity. Okay. That polarity is basically the polarity of the input signal. Then you let it go and then remove the reset, then it will regenerate itself. Okay. So, now once you are familiar a little bit with transistors, you can even come up with your own topologies. Now, what is special about the, and some are good and some are bad, it depends on like how fast it will regenerate and things like that. Okay. So, that is basically that. And also one of the important criteria is how many clock phases you need. That is, you have many switches. Now, if you have to give like different signals to all of these things, like clock here, clock bar there, and clock a little bit offset there and so on, it is just too much. The clock distribution becomes too painful. Okay. So, this strong arm latch is one of those latches where you need only a single clock signal. That is the virtue of it. Okay. So, otherwise the general principle is the same. You have a cross coupled pair, this is known as a cross coupled pair, and then you establish initial conditions and you let it go. Okay. So, how do you do that? Essentially this IP and IM, the way it is done is like this. You have essentially what looks like a differential pair, but you do not have a current source, but you have a switch. This is clock. Okay. And the classic strong arm latch, there can be other modifications to this, also has these switches. Which are also given the same signal. Okay. So, the clock, there is a single clock signal that is applied to the bottom NMOS transistor as well as those two PMOS transistors. First, let us assume clock is 0. What happens then? What happens? This is the supply voltage VDD. If clock is 0, there are only 3 transistors influenced by the clock. So, what happens to them? So, the upper transistors, these PMOS transistors will be on. Okay. So, this VOP will be equal to VDD and VOM also will be equal to VDD. And this is just inactive, this is off, right. So, the bottom part is not relevant. So, this is the reset state, right. Meaning, whatever value was held on VOP and VOM previously, it is gone. It is just like tied to VDD. Okay. That is, if you have only this part, yes, but that is not all we have. I mean, I can take a switch and connect it to VDD, right? Basically, I force it to VDD, that is all, okay. And secondly, so this can be done with any latch. Now, secondly, the picture we have is not even like that, because the bottom part is not grounded, okay. So, this side there is no current at all. So, these NMOS transistors anyway cannot turn on, okay. So, everything is just off and then those nodes get tied to VDD, okay. So, if you want to do it in this latch, when these inverters are active, then these switches should have a low resistance and they will also draw a lot of current, because the NMOS transistors in both inverters will be on, and this switch should supply that current while keeping a small voltage drop. But anyway, this is not the situation we have. From the bottom, we have turned off this, so no current is flowing through the NMOS transistor. Is this okay? So, similarly, if you have this connection, right, and then reset it like this, then also the circuit will be drawing a lot of current, okay. This is like a self biased inverter, right. Both NMOS and PMOS will be on and it will be drawing a lot of current. So, one of the virtues of strong arm is basically you open circuit the bottom part of it, so that when it is reset, it is not drawing any current either. So, there is no static current in this. Is it okay? So, you start with clock equal to 0, it is reset, and then let us say clock becomes 1. What happens now? It will regenerate, or what, just after clock becomes to 1, clock goes to 1, what starts happening? So, when it is reset, right, the bottom part is turned off, okay. So, this is at VDD, this is at VDD, and because of leakages, these things are also likely to move to some high voltage, okay, close to VDD, right. So, essentially, then the moment you turn on the clock, what happens is current starts flowing, okay. How much current flows depends on the resistance of this device and the initial voltage and so on. And also, if VIP is not equal to VIM, these currents will be different from each other, okay. So, these currents, this current flows through this branch and IM flows through this, and it starts lowering VOP and VOM, and maybe I will call these like VXP and VXM, okay. So, initially all these transistors are off, I mean these 4 transistors, this, because everything is tied to sort of the terminal voltages are all 0, okay. But this the current from this differential pair starts pulling down these nodes, okay. Initially both are at VDD, just to distinguish between them I show some separation, and then after that they start falling, okay. And I assume that somehow this IP is more than IM, okay. If VIP is more than VIM, this IP will be more than IM. So, the nodes on the left side start falling down more rapidly compared to the nodes on the right side, okay. Is this fine? What happens after that?
The
Yeah, I mean, it's not an inverter in that the bottom side is not grounded. So what happens is, so let's say this, let me mark the, this node, right? This is the gate of this PMOS transistor, okay? I marked this because VOM is falling more rapidly. So at some point it falls below VDD minus VT and this turns on, okay? And similarly, this starts falling, okay? Now, as this VXM falls, remember this VOP is falling more slowly, right? So, the NMOS on the left side turns on also. Is this clear? So, let me mark this MP1, MN1, MP2, MN2, okay. So, VOM and VOP are both falling, but VOM is falling more rapidly, okay. So, MP2 turns on before MP1, is that clear? This is VOP, this is VOM, okay. If I draw only the PMOS transistor, this is the picture we have. VOM is falling more rapidly, so MP2 turns on first, okay. Similarly, if you look at MN1 and MN2, the gate of MN1 is tied to VOP, the source is tied to VXM, and here it is tied to VOM, okay. So, these are falling more rapidly than VOP. So, again this transistor turns on, MN1 turns on before MN2, okay. This is what you want. Basically, the PMOS on the right side turns on, the NMOS on the left side turns on. So, it will pull the right side node towards VDD and the left side node towards ground, okay. Now, as these voltages fall, this VXM and VXP, these input transistors are also going to the triode region. Okay. So, as they go into triode region, what happens? The influence of the input voltage disappears, right? Because, I mean, initially these are in saturation. When they turn on, their drain voltages are quite high, and if I call these, let us say MI1 and MI2, meaning the input differential pair, they are in saturation region. So, they have the maximum possible GM. So, any input difference translates to a large current difference. Now, as the voltages keep falling, these enter triode region. So, when you know, I mean, basically in triode region, the drain source voltage influences the current, and if the drain source voltage is very small, the GM becomes very small. I think you know the, what is the expression for GM in the triode region of a transistor? No, GM, the expression for GM. What is GM? It is just proportional to VDS. So, as VDS becomes smaller, its GM reduces. So, that means that this input no longer has influence on that, okay. So, that is what you wanted, right? I mean, in the model that I gave you for the flip flop, I had actually a sample and hold. You sample it, then the input has full influence, and then you remove it, it has no influence. In this case, it is not as abrupt, but you can see the same thing happening, okay. So, initially the input pair draws currents and it has influence on the output nodes. After a while, the regeneration takes over, and anyway the input differential pair is getting crushed and it has no influence on the output node. So, that is like the holding part. So, the actual sampling instant is a little bit vague, but it will be somewhere there, okay. At some point the input, the output voltage is no longer dependent on the input difference, but basically some state that has been stored, okay. Is this fine? So, this is one of those circuits, I mean. Yeah, obviously, it is like horribly nonlinear and so on. You cannot sit and write equations for it, but it is quite easy to understand, and then you can simulate it and find out, okay. So, these things starts falling, these two nodes, and at some point as the PMOS and NMOS turn on, this will they will turn on to a sufficient degree that regeneration takes over and it does that. Okay. And this is roughly the sampling instant. Okay. Is this fine? So now, as you can imagine, let's say you have just the clock has become 1, the outputs have just started falling, then the inputs change. What happens? The clock has become 1, the outputs have started falling, but it has not yet entered the regeneration phase, but the inputs are continuous time, they go on changing. So what happens? They will affect it. So actually it is not a sort of single sampling instant. What happens is sort of roughly everything that happens in this region, right, it affects the starting point of the regeneration. Okay. So, it is not a single instant at which it is sampled, but it is sort of the average of the input over a certain window, and that is known as the aperture of the latch. The narrower it is, the better. In fact, if it is 0 duration, that means you have an instantaneous sampling. Okay. But no real sampling will be instantaneous. Even that sample and hold, right, you make a switch and a capacitor, it is not as though that has a single, like it has instantaneous sampling. As the switch is opening, the resistance goes on increasing. So, the output voltage does change as it is changing. So, the actual stored value is not the input at a exact instant, but averaged over certain aperture. The narrower the aperture is, the higher the sampling speed with which you can use that. Okay, the higher the bandwidth of sampling. Is this okay? So, there is some aperture, and there is some, actually there is a pretty nice paper which illustrates all these things in more analytical detail. We won't go into that. I'll just describe these things qualitatively. Okay. Any questions about this? Now, let us say the input difference, this is plotted for some particular value of input difference voltage. Now, I will take another case in which the input difference is smaller than this. What will happen? Huh? Okay. Yeah. So, the most important thing is that the, so now, so let us say this is the rising edge of clock, right, and from there it takes a certain amount of time for it to regenerate to full logic levels. But if you start with a smaller input voltage, what happens is that the average rate may be the same, but the difference builds up more slowly. Okay, you understand? I mean, if the difference is 0, then both the arms have the same current, and then there in ideally there is no difference at all. Okay. So it does this, and then it kind of does that, and the delay will be this much. Okay. Now, if you think of this as a flip flop, this is the clock to Q delay, right? The rising edge of the clock is the sampling edge of the clock, and from there when you get a decision, you can define it however you want, maybe when it reaches 90% of the logic levels or more, okay. Whatever it is, that is the clock to queue delay, and you know that, I mean you can see that the clock to queue delay is not a fixed quantity, it depends on the input amplitude. This is true for any kind of latch, I mean it's I have shown it with the example of strong arm latch. In fact, the issues that we discuss here apply to any other latch as well, okay. So there is a trade-off between the delay of the latch and the resolution that you can get, okay. In principle you can resolve arbitrarily small inputs, but it will take a long time, okay. So that's why you should have, it is good to have a sufficiently large signal at the input of the latch, as large as you can have, but you know the other constraints as well, you can't make it very large simply because of supply voltage limitations. And then also the need to keep everything linear in case you are using DFE and so on, okay. In the olden days at lower data rates when you didn't need equalization, but you could have transmission over a very long distance. So the signal would become very small, but the eye wouldn't close. So then what you would have is just a chain of amplifiers, it is in fact known as a limiting amplifier, it would even limit to the full rail, it is like nonlinear, but because the eye is open that is okay, right. So, you have a lot of gain and then you have, after that you have a D flip flop and you are done, okay. Now you have to also keep things linear. So, now you can also very clearly see why the eye opening is important, right. In the vertical direction obviously it sets the initial conditions of the latch. It is also important in the horizontal direction because you need to give enough time for it to establish the initial conditions and regenerate, otherwise you have a problem as well, okay. Yeah. That's correct. So in fact there is also other problems with resetting to VDD. The question he is asking is that the output nodes, right, these two nodes are reset to VDD. So, both have to come down from VDD and then regenerate. So, just by looking at that picture, it looks better if they were reset to some mid value and then you regenerate from there, right. So, could we do that? How do you do that? Yeah. If you just have a switch between the two and you turn off the bottom, it will still probably drift up to VDD, okay. So, you have to actually connect it to VCM, but now that is complicated, okay. So, can we do that instead of this? Anyway, good, this is how you invent circuits, you can see what if and so on. So, let us say we have VCM and I remove these PMOS switches, I have these. So, will this work? What difficulties do you foresee? That's okay. I mean, they are equal. I just tie them to the same node. That's not a problem. Yeah. Which one? Really? Why will MN1 and MN2 turn on? Is it possible for MN1 and MN2 to turn on? So, this the signal for this, what is the logic signal controlling the switch? What is it? Clock bar, yeah. So, this is a PMOS switch whose gate is connected to clock, basically it is a switch with a control signal of clock bar. So, these are clock bar. So, when clock is 0, can you have currents in the NMOS transistor? Why? Because the bottom is turned off, so you cannot have currents in the NMOS transistor. So, what other issues do you see? Do you see any issues or this is a, I mean we can just start using this. Large? Why? Large skew between? Oh, clock skew between clock and clock bar. Yeah, I mean, depends on how we implement the switch. If we have to implement, if we have to generate both clock and clock bar, generating them, I mean, distributing them without skew also can be a challenge. Okay, what else? Yeah, so now you can see that essentially these PMOS transistors, they are diode connected and connected between VDD and VCM, right? Because both the gate and drain are connected to VCM. So, the PMOS transistors can be on. Earlier in the reset phase, there was no power consumption. Okay. Once it is reset, those are at VDD, no current is flowing. So, now there will be current flowing through the PMOS transistors. Okay. What other problems do you foresee? How do you make those switches? PMOS? How would I implement those two switches? Basically, I mean, it's always difficult to switch near mid rail compared to near the top or bottom, right? Especially with now that we have small supplies, this is a problem. When we had a 10 volt supply and a threshold of 1 volt, I mean, it is okay. You can do it. Maybe you just need a bigger size. But now, these switches are very bad. I mean, switches near switches that have to switch signals near VCM by 2, they'll neither be fully on nor be fully off. I mean, it's just a poor thing. So you have to use transmission gates. And that needs like two phase clocks. Even if the clocks themselves were not a problem, these switches are a problem. Okay, they won't be good switches. Okay, so that's why it's actually, if you do all this, you will still have probably worse performance with this than with resetting it to VDD. Any other questions? Now that's it. I mean, the operation is kind of simple that way. That is, a difference voltage establishes a difference current, which causes some asymmetry in the ramping up on the left, ramping down of the left and right sides. So, and at some point, the switches, the transistors in the cross coupled pair take over, and they start regenerating from there. And they start regenerating from whichever, I mean, basically in the same direction as the asymmetry. Okay. Now, ideally what should happen is, if VIP is more than VIM, then the left side should have more current. Okay. Then eventually, this VOP should go to VDD and VOM should go to ground. And similarly, if left side is slightly less than VIP is slightly less than VIM, the opposite should happen. This should happen for however small the input difference is. The only difference is in the time it takes. Okay. It could take a long time to resolve this. Okay. Now, as you know, I mean, this is, that is basically the output should reflect the sign of VIP minus VIM. Okay. Will it do that exactly? Are there any problems that prevent you from distinguishing the sign accurately or determining the sign accurately of VIP minus VIM? Yeah. First of all, there is a random mismatch between devices. So, between which devices are we concerned with? Input pair, definitely, right? Because we expect that if VIP is more than VIM, this current, the left side current should be more than the right side current. But that happens only if these two transistors don't have any mismatch. If they have mismatch, it could be that if VIP is more than VIM, but still the current here is smaller. So, the threshold mismatch and the current factor mismatch of the input pair directly comes into picture. The mismatch of these cross coupled transistors also come into picture, in that I assume that if let's say more current is flowing on the left side, then the right side PMOS will turn on first, but because of mismatch that may not happen. Okay, so it could still start regenerating in the opposite direction. So they also have some effect. Okay. So the mismatch of these transistors, the input pair and the cross coupled pairs, will surely have an effect on the offset. Okay. So eventually the latch will have some offset and you just have to live with it. You can't do anything about it. Okay. So what this means is your eye should be sufficiently open such that the eye opening minus the offset still gives you a sufficiently low bit error rate, because now this is skewing decisions to one side, right? Okay. That is no different from any other offset that you have seen, right? I mean, in an op amp you will have the input device, load devices, and any mismatch between them will cause offset and so on. Okay. Now, in this particular case, do you see any other source of mismatch? That is, transistor mismatch, that's fine. Then what other things can you see? I mean, I'll give you a hint. Basically, the output node start at VDD and start ramping down at different rates. And at some point from that initial condition, it starts regenerating. So, what could affect that? Yeah, that let us say is okay. I mean, what else can be mismatched? What is that? Initial conditions are okay. Let us say that is, I mean, there are PMOS switches tying it to VDD, right? So, I think that should be okay. Noise is a different thing. Noise will affect decisions, but so first of all, this slope here, right, the slope of this ramp depends on the parasitic capacitance here. The parasitic capacitance is also could be mismatched. Okay. So what happens is, even if you draw equal currents from here, these two could be ramping down at different rates. Okay. So, mismatch in parasitics also cause an offset in this case, right? That this is unlike an op amp. In an op amp, I mean the capacitance is not going to cause an offset, whereas here it will, because imagine that VIP is exactly equal to VIM and all transistor sizes are matched except only the output parasitic capacitors are matched. I mean, who knows why? Maybe the following stage has different capacitors at the two nodes, or you made the layout asymmetrical. Okay. So, then what happens is one side will ramp down more slowly compared to the other. So, that will get resolved to VDD, the other side will get resolved to ground. Okay. So, this is known as dynamic offset, and so obviously, this is also a source of offset. Okay. Okay. So, again the context is quite important. This is for high speed serial links, right. So, you will keep all transistor sizes to a minimum and so on. So, mismatch is likely to be high to begin with, and then you are also talking about very small devices. So, small extra wire parasitics here and there also matter. Okay. So, these this parasitic capacitance mismatch causes dynamic offset. Okay. Finally, with all of this, there will be some sensitivity limit that you have to take into account while designing the serial. Okay. Now, sometimes actually this parasitic capacitance mismatch, I mean, many of these things you can exploit. So, people in fact do this. This makes the, this is probably not that important for serial links, but in other cases where you want low offset. So, what you do is you have variable capacitance on the two sides, okay, and you can deliberately mismatch the capacitance and you can correct for the offset. Okay. First of all, you can correct for a parasitic mismatch, and in fact, you can even correct for the transistor mismatch. If the transistor mismatch is skewing it in one direction, you can make the capacitor mismatch skew it in the other direction. Okay. Now, you need to have a way of detecting the offset, right. So, one possible way is, let us say you have a very small amplitude input signal and it is making decisions purely based on random noise. And if you are sure that it is random noise, you should see 50% ones and 50% zeros. So, based on that you can decide whether the latch has an offset or not and then correct it. Okay. So, you can use these for offset correction. Now, you have to realize that in a way you are making the latch worse by doing this, because you are adding extra capacitors, the delay is only going to increase. Okay. But again, it depends on, if in a given process you do not need to reach the highest speed possible, then you can afford to give up a little bit on the speed while correcting for the offset. Okay. So, you can make it symmetric, but now both sides will be slower than if you did not put this at all. Is this okay? So, basically what I have done is to show the strong arm latch, because that's a like extremely popular latch, it is used all the time. One of the main attractions is that you have a single phase clock going into the latch. So, this avoids the need for distributing multiple phases, which can be a real pain. Okay. If you have clock A, clock B, clock C with like different phases with all the same periods, all this is nice to write on the book, but once you make it and then to distribute all of them while maintaining the same phase relationship, that is quite difficult. It can consume a lot of power by itself. Okay. So, now I mean, if you make any other latch, there are improvements to this as well, and there may be other kinds of latches which may be suitable for whatever reason. So, then you should look for these issues, whether they are important or not is different, but these are all the issues that can come into picture. Okay. And again, this transistor sizing is of course largely by simulation. You try to keep the sizes as small as possible, but you need to have a certain size. I mean, if you make the input pairs and this very small, what happens is the input sensitivity becomes very limited, right? Because basically the input sensitivity depends on how much current difference you can get for a given input voltage difference. For that you need to make the inputs bigger. Okay. At the same time, there is always, I mean, in fact, this is another thing as well, in a latch there is a trade off between how sensitive it is to the input versus the delay in regeneration. Because if the input this is very strong, let us say the bottom part of this is very strong. So, the input current difference will be huge even for a small input difference, and then it takes a longer time for the regeneration pair to take over. Okay. I am assuming that for a given latch size, you go on increasing this, the input sensitivity will improve, but you can see that the input will have influence for a longer period into the ramping period, right. So, the holding stuff can become worse. But you can play these games to, let us say, change the clock to Q delay and those things. Now, what happens is once you make a decision, right, the output of this latch This is for when clock is 0, the output nodes will be at VDD. When clock is 1, the output nodes will be at the appropriate logic levels. So, the output actually is valid only for half the clock period. So, what is done is to make it valid for the entire clock period. These two outputs and when clock is 1, it has the appropriate decision. Okay. Now, I do not want this, I do not want it going off to VDD for half the clock period. Okay. So, what can I use after this to make sure that it basically gives you only the decisions? Latch. So, the common thing that is used, what is that? Inverters. How will that help? You should try and avoid like more clock phases, right. So, if you want to sample this, you will have to find out when it actually regenerates and then sample it. That may be possible, but there is another circuit which is commonly used. I think you know this circuit for sure. Basically, that circuit does not react when the two inputs are high, but then when the two inputs are complementary, it will give you something. So, it is basically the SR latch with NAND gates. Okay. So, what happens is, when these are complementary, the outputs will also get set to complementary values, but then when both of these become 1, it will be held, right. So, now this will, if VOP and VOM do this, they keep doing that, these two outputs RS will do that. Okay. Which one? VO? It will be 0. So, when I think the question is, what will be the final value of VOM? I mean, let us say the right side is regenerating to VDD, the left side is regenerating towards lower, towards ground. Where will it stop? Yeah, it will be just these two will be in triode region. This transistor will be strongly on, this will also be strongly on. Basically, you will have three transistors from VOM to ground. So, there will be some, but I mean, this transistor will be off. So, there will be no current. So, if you wait long enough, this point will reach ground. So, the SR latch is used to get full width pulses. Is this okay? So, very simple circuit, but almost always used in every serial link where you have to make a decision. You can also use it as a D flip flop. Okay? So, if you use it as a D flip flop, what kind of a flip flop is that? I mean, how does it behave with the clock? Basically, a rising edge triggered flip flop, right. Essentially, I mean, roughly speaking, it is a rising edge triggered flip flop. There will be some delay between the clock going up and it making a decision, but essentially, when the clock goes up, it is like looking at the values of VIP minus VIM and giving you a logic value based on that. So, it can be used as a deep flip flop. This fine. So, we looked at this in quite a bit of detail. So, we do not have to look at other latches in as much detail. Like I said, there are some bazillion topologies, people have proposed their own improvements to either this or the latches can look completely different also, but the issues that we discuss will be there in every latch and you have to look forward. Okay. So, we will wrap up the course tomorrow with maybe like one more latch and some other considerations.